Thank you. gave you a song.
Down the years to grow. Thank you. Think of what would look good anyway, and then something you haven't done before, something which is hopefully appealing, something hopefully nobody else has done before, which is always a problem. And you can get all very arty about it and say, well, the music should stand out for itself, but that's only half the battle, because you don't listen to a television, you look at it. I made it on my second album, and I'd never been on big concert tour supporting anybody. I hadn't even headlined at clubs or anything like that, so I went from absolutely nothing, rock bottom, to about as big as you can get in this country anyway. And it was very much, it's very difficult, really. And you're put in the same class as people like, obviously, Bowie and Brian Ferry and all the others of that class. Standard, which is nice in my respect, but very difficult in another, because they've been doing it for 10, 15 years and you've been doing it for about 10 or 15 days. And so it's, I also had a lot to learn.
We'll be right back. Gary, I'd like to start by asking you about the Berserker tour and album in 1984. Now, 1984 was an interesting year for you. You started your own record label, Numa Records, and with the Berserker album, you produced a fresh new synthesized sound, which was quite different compared to your previous three albums. How did the new direction come about?
Mainly to do with Trevor Horn, who was producing the Frankie Goes to Hollywood stuff. It seemed at the time that it just took production to a completely different level to where it had been before, and I loved it a lot. So it was an attempt really to try to follow that sort of production style that Trevor Horn had done, and the songs kind of developed alongside that really. So the songwriting part of it wasn't necessarily influenced by the Frankie Goes to Hollywood type thing. That was more the production that came later. So we would get songs finished, bring them into the studio and try to add different parts to them and just see if it worked or not, if it suited the new style of production, suited those songs or not. And overall it was good actually, it worked really well.
Now to go with your new sound, you had a stark new image. How did the concept come about?
I saw a photograph in a magazine, and I think it was years before, and it was a woman laying on a tree and it was snow covered, and she was all painted to look like snow, I guess. And there was another one where some woman was laying on marble, and I think they painted her to look like marble. And I just remembered, I thought it looked really, really cool. So again, it was another sort of like feeble attempt to go along that particular path. I think the album cover was used in a German magazine as their front cover, and I think he got cover of the year or something. He thought it was a bit naughty, really. It's my cover. They nicked it and they get an award for it. But it was quite striking. It's good.
And what was the actual overall theme of the album and the Berserker title?
I don't know if it had an overall theme. Possibly, too long ago to remember now. But the title itself, when I was younger, there were these Berserker books, but I think it's a man called Fred Saberhagen wrote them. But I was really into them when I was a kid. And there was like Berserker's Planet and Brother Berserker. And these were machines that were really vicious. You know, they were fantastic sort of sci-fi type stories. And so that's where it came from initially. But then I found out about the whole Viking Berserker thing, where they get themselves into this drug-crazed kind of state of war and raping and pillaging, and that was called Berserker. So there was a few connections really along the way, but initially it started with the little sci-fi books.
Gary, how frustrating was the distribution problems that you had with Numa Records to start with, that led to Berserker not charting as high as it could have done?
It's annoying. We had all kinds of problems, to be honest, and a lot of it was our own fault by being over optimistic about how it was going to go, and you know, expecting to get radio play. It was the first album that we'd done on our own, really, since leaving Beggars Banquet. So we kind of went into it with a frame of mind that we'd had when we was with the Beggars / Warner Brothers Universal sort of package, and you just expected things to kind of pick up where we left them off before, which would have meant getting some radio play and so on, you know. So we printed masses of these records enough to fill a small bloody factory, which didn't sell, didn't get the radio play. You know, the whole thing just bit us quite badly. And the distribution problems were just another little fly in the ointment. Just trying to get something like that underway efficiently was a lot more tricky than we realised. We just thought it'd be a done deal. You know, you pick up the phone, you do a deal, it's going to come out this day, we give you the records on that day, and they'll be in the shops by that day. It should be fairly simple, really. But it doesn't always quite work like that. It was frustrating, you know. It was a big move for me to leave Beggars and go off on my own. And you wanted things to be smooth. And obviously you wanted it to be successful, because there was a lot of people thought that I was finished at that point. So it was very important to us. And so these little annoyances that came along really were a pain, actually.
Now, both Martin Gore and Andy Fletcher of Depeche Mode are big fans of the Berserker album. Likewise, many fans regard the album as a classic. Looking back, what do you think about it?
I was really pleased at the time. There was a period sometime after that where I was, with hindsight, less keen on some of the records that came later. But I think with Berserker, I was still really happy with what I was doing. Really happy, actually. I wouldn't say it's one of my all-time favourites, but it's not one of the ones I'm slightly ashamed of.
Now, as you say, hindsight is a wonderful thing. Now, do you think if you'd have taken the synthesised sound of Berserker to maybe a darker, more industrial level way back in 1984, going into 85, do you think that your late 80s career would have taken maybe a different path, maybe more of the top Depeche Mode style?
It's possible. It's really difficult to know for sure, because so much of it, again, depends on media exposure for it. It probably, or possibly, wouldn't have mattered what sort of album it was, whether it was heavy industrial or not. Because if the media didn't pick up on it and promote it, then nobody would have heard it anyway. So, why would that have had any effect then, if it was a different kind of music? On the other hand, it wouldn't have gone by completely unnoticed, and maybe it would have done. But you can only write and put out music the way you're feeling at the time and based on the things that you're interested in at the time and what you want to achieve with it, really. And at that particular time, I had a very different sort of head on my shoulders to what I've had more recently with the industrial thing. But still, I think the album was the right album for me at that time. I think when Dance came out, to come out after two number one albums with something like Dance, which is a bit obscure, really. Big mistake, probably. But, again, that's what I wanted to do. And then by the time I get to Berserker, I thought I was pretty much back on track again for a while.
Now, what made you decide to film the Berserker tour?
Greed. I don't know. Was it even my decision?
So Gary, obviously the Berserker tour in 1984 was filmed in its entirety, which of course is now on the DVD what we're talking about. Now, were video productions very costly at the time?
Yeah, that was ridiculous, actually. I'm not sure if it needed to be that way, or is it because it's a relatively new technology that came along. People tend to charge a premium because it's new and everybody wants it. But whether it was justified or not, I really don't know too much about it, but it was very, very expensive, I know that. And you always did get the feeling that you were being turned over slightly when these stupid budgets would come in for these things, hundreds of thousands of pounds sometimes. Not that we ever did those, but that some of the people would come back with quotes that were just amazing. What's that for? But yeah, there was a lot of people making quite a lot of money, I think, when all this kind of thing first started to happen, which is clever then.
Now, of course, at the same time, on the same night of the concert, you also released the White Noise live album, an EP. Were you surprised that a live album like that did so well?
Yeah, I was actually, because our experience with putting the Berserker album out and the singles associated with it had been a bit of a step backwards, really. And so when the live stuff came out and did well, and there's one or two places in Europe it did really well, it just seemed to sort of come from nowhere, really. But it was really, really cool, because it was a little bit demoralising, to be honest, our move onto our own label, and it hadn't gone as slickly as we'd hoped and had been quite a few problems with it. And for the live stuff to come out and do really well, it picked you up from that sort of disappointment as well. No, it was good. To this day I don't quite know why it did what it did,
Okay, what are your recollections of the Berserker tour? I mean, was it a good atmosphere with the band and the crew? Did everyone get on?
It's all right. It's all right. There was a few ripples here and there. Generally speaking, it was pretty cool. The band then was quite different to the band I have now. You know, the band I have now, like you see today, you know, the people are here from it, and we just have a fantastic sort of social life. You know, we see each other all the time, and they're really good friends, and it's a lovely thing. So when you go out on tour, it's just a bunch of mates going out and just looking out for each other and having a nice time. The first band, it wasn't really quite as good as that, to be honest. You know, everyone got on when we were touring, but when the tours were finished, I didn't see anybody. You know, so we didn't hang out together, anything like that. So it was slightly more workmanlike, business-like kind of arrangement. And so you didn't have the same closeness then as I did now. But as I remember it, everyone got on pretty well. Remember one great big ruck at London about people wanting too many guests to come in and expecting me to pay for them. So you want your friends to come in to the gig and you want me to pay for it. But they're your friends. You pay for it. Why am I going to buy tickets for your scroty friends? Yeah, anyway. Sounds a bit petty, doesn't it? You annoyed me, though.
Now, Gary, the Berserker tour was pretty spectacular, and you said you wanted to dazzle the audience with lots of white light, and you still had a big stage set, which you've since described as a high-tech version of a Roman temple. What's your take on the Berserker tour lights?
It was a bit of a compromise, really, using stuff that we had before, from the Fury, is it? Or was that? No, that was later, wasn't it?
That was the year after.
Some of it came from the touring principle, the first one. The little panels on the bottom that I think were in front of the risers, and then the columns around the back. It felt a little bit, we were trying to bring it back from where it had been, because we just couldn't afford to keep touring the way we had been, because we were losing money, selling out tours but still losing money on them, and you just can't keep doing that, especially as the record sales were now beginning to slide away quite badly as well. Suddenly the whole financial side of it become a real issue, a real problem. Whereas before, we'll have 10 of them and a spare. It was stupid, too much money, too little brain. So that was all beginning to become, we had it more under control, I think. We were learning to. Like my dad said, that we were always one step behind our decline. We would do things, think, it's not going quite as well as we thought. Change things, cut a few corners, take more on ourselves. Ah, there we go. And while we were doing that, it actually got a little bit worse. So we were always chasing the problem downwards for quite some time until we finally got ourselves sorted out. But the light show had that slight feel to me of being still trying to keep it big and spectacular, the size of it and the complexity and the flexibility of the lights and what things they could do. Really, really important. But nonetheless, we were now trying to do it on a much more reduced budget. So we were using bits of old light shows and then trying to reshape them so you didn't notice so much. A little bit cost cutting, really. But necessity and all that. So, it had to be done. And we probably should have done it a lot more. But we would have been chasing the problem for the next 10 years. But I think the light show was really cool. I mean, if I had that light show now, I'd be more than happy. But at the time, it seemed a step backwards from where we'd been.
Now, Gary, 1984, you were getting heavily into air display flying. And of course, at that point, you'd already seen some of your friends die in accidents. Is it true that you didn't expect to live past 30 still?
At the time, yeah. Yeah, it didn't seem likely to me. Not in a morbid way or trying to be dramatic about it. Just seemed, you're looking around at how many people are doing it, and not that many people do it. And more now, actually, but then there wasn't that many people doing it. And seeing how many of them are getting killed each year, you could pretty much work out a life expectancy from that, if you were lucky. And 30 seemed to be about it. If I was lucky, I'd get to about that. Just everyone, people much better than me were killing themselves. having horrible accidents. So it just seemed obvious and an inevitable thing, really. But it wasn't frightened. But you know when something is always 5-10 years in the future, you don't panic about it quite so much as if it's going to be tomorrow. And that's kind of the attitude, really. It probably going to happen, but it wouldn't be today. So it stayed exciting.
The PPG synth seems to have a big impact on the style of the Berserker album. So what was special about this machine?
It was a sample-based machine, one of the very early generation of a kit that you could put your own samples into. You could create samples. You know, for example, we went out and we would put microphones on various things and bash stuff, and you could then bring that into the machine. We've been able to do that before, but with the Wave, you could then manipulate it in ways that you hadn't been able to do before. And it all went through a keyboard and just phenomenal sounds. I just never heard anything like it. And very, very different to synthesizer. Well, synthesizers as they'd been up to that point anyway. It just felt like a massive step forward and in what you could do and the way you could experiment to what we've been able to do before. But it was really complicated and really, really quirky, bizarre little thing. Like it had a personality all of its own, and it was always difficult. Always doing stuff. What's it doing that for? And you spend half a day sometimes trying to get back to where you were before it just decided to dump everything. So it was a troublesome bit of kit, but when it worked, absolutely brilliant, brilliant.
And so by today's standards, of course, how would it compare?
You'd probably get it in your watch. I'd imagine the computing power of it, it was laughable compared to what we have now. But it was fantastic, and you can still get those sort of machines now, but they just become part of the mainstream, really. You know, you can get them for hundreds of pounds now, and I think that thing was tens of thousands. I didn't buy it, you know. But yeah. But one of the advantages of being one of the first in with that kind of technology is that you get all the benefit of the newness of the sound and things that people have never heard before. But you also get all the teething problems, and you're like a bug fixer, really. You're just trying to work it, find out what's wrong with it, tell them. You know, they'll send a fix out for it, and you keep them going. So it is frustrating, but you know that when it's working, no one else has it or anything like it. You know? So it was, I found it really exciting, because all the problems that came with it, they weren't really mine. Mike and Ian would have to sort them out. So I'd just go out and wander about for a bit, you know, and then come back an hour later and say, you fixed it. Yeah, and they hadn't. So it was easy for me, but I think they had a right nightmare with it.
So when you came to Mike and Ian, did you actually come with the piano pieces and did you write the originals on the piano as such?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, in those days it was all done like that. I had a little metronome at home, a little clicker, and I would just stick that on and just play an upright piano, and all the songs are written that way. And then that would come into the studio, and then you would stick all your bits and pieces on top of that. So the production and the recording were very, very, the production and the writing were very, very separate. When these days they kind of go together. It's all part of the process now. The production and the writing seem to be, they happen at the same time.
So Gary, at what point did you realise on the Berserker tour that the heavy makeup and the full leather image that was going to cause a problem under the heat and the lights, really?
Fairly quickly, about 3 or 4 songs into the first gig, I think. Yeah, there's a few problems, really. First of all, it is so hot and you're sweating badly and it all just starts to run. You know, so I've got this white stuff and blue everywhere and it's all just running, looks a mess. And then you're singing close up on the mic. And I got blue lips, and so that all gets wiped off straight away. It's got these stupid little pink bits in the middle, like a parrot. Yeah, just it looked dreadful, actually. It didn't really stand up to touring too well. And it took like 2 hours every night to put it on. Real pain. But
how long did it take to actually take off?
Not too bad getting it off, because half of it had gone anyway by the time the gig was finished. But not too bad, but yeah, every day. And then having a blue hair, I think, and having to dye your hair almost every day, so every other day. And just, it was a high maintenance image, that one. I felt I learned so much from that one. I think from that one onwards, I was pretty much done with high maintenance images.
Now, Gary, although we know you've scoured the archives, can you confirm that the original master tapes for Berserker are pretty well missing, basically? And you, to your best of your knowledge, there's no more unreleased material that you're aware of?
I have found some bits and pieces from Berserker that we had archived from, but we had a massive amount of those big 2-inch multi-track tapes, and all of that has been converted onto radar now, so it's much easier to manage and store. And I was looking through that the other day, and I did find some Berserker tracks on there, but nothing that was that hadn't been released before. You know, it's all known stuff that's been out. So I don't think there's anything.
And video as well, obviously relating to the concert as well. There's no other, apart from of course what's on this the Berserker DVD, the new release. Mm. There's nothing else that you know of that's anywhere really. There's no other hidden archives.
No. There might be fan bootlegs floating about. The little camcorder films from the gig itself, which tend to be a bit rubbish, don't they, really? So there might be some of that floating about, but no, there's nothing that I know.
I'd like to make clear, actually, to the fans, of course, of the further note, this DVD will actually contain the full concert for the first time, including, of course, the intro that no one's ever seen, which is the full unedited intro to Berserker, so that's obviously going to be quite good. And finally, Gary...
don't remember that. I remember it myself.
And finally, Gary, looking back at the whole Berserker year of 1984, I mean, did you enjoy it, or was it a good time, do you think?
It was good. It's one of those strange things, really. You know, going from as big as I'd been before, and then it all sort of falling away a little bit throughout the Warriors period, and then going off on a run with Berserker, it was definitely less than it had been before. But we were confident that we could sort of turn that around, learn from our mistakes with getting a new record company underway, and just do a better job of it in the future, really. So it felt optimistic, but we knew it was much harder than we thought it was going to be. And there is that clear recognition, really, that the career is not at the same level that it was at before. And so if you were going to get back, then you had to make some good decisions, and we didn't actually. But at the time, you know, it felt like it was a savable situation. So yeah, optimistic, I would say.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Gary. Thanks for your time. Thank you.